Okay, remember, we are studying the 40 grace gifts. We are studying that the believer is now on a secure foundation. We've been covering this. The passage that we've been using is out of 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 11 through 15. And we are just going to be moving on. We're not going to backtrack on that. We're going to talk about the last 5 minutes of our 5 or 10 minutes of our last class, so that we may be able to move on into our study and to study Ephesians. And you can turn there, if you will, to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17. Remember what we have talked about, walking, that Paul says in Ephesians 4:17 that we are not to walk in the futility of the minds of the Gentiles. We were talking really about what this means about the walk. It is more than just saying that about covering our spiritual walk, but we define that walk even a deeper definition of that, exactly what that involves. We said the word peripatetao is the word that is used there, and we said the root word of that is peri, and we mentioned how peri is connected with perimeter. We were talking about a complete circle. We were talking about that, and we were talking about how, in military terms, we're to guard the perimeter. We're not to allow anything to enter into that perimeter, because we're always on guard. We're always focused on that perimeter, and that's what peripatetao is. It is a complete circle, and we're to maintain that in our spiritual walk. We're to maintain a complete circle of divine viewpoint thinking. I mean, we carried this last week. And so what we draw from here on Ephesians 4:17, what we have learned is that the spiritual life, the walk of the believer, is a constant focus and attention in the development of the thinking process. It is constantly focused on that. We are to be constantly completing the result of an unbroken circle in our thinking. Always in divine viewpoint. That is the walk. We're not walking in the futility of the mind of the Gentiles. We are not walking in human viewpoint. We are walking in divine viewpoint. We are to be motivated in a high personal interest or an involvement of paying attention to every point and detail that is in this circle or circle. Just like in the military, if we are guarding the perimeter, everything is of importance to us that is inside that perimeter. We do not want it to be broken in any way. If it is broken in any way, we mention how the enemy can infiltrate into that perimeter. If we are not in constant thinking of divine viewpoint, if that is that circle becomes broken, then that human viewpoint thinking can creep in and it can begin to saturate and overtake what is inside that circle. Ephesians 5:1-2, where it says, and it reads this way, "Therefore be imitators of God as dear children, and walk in love as Christ also has loved us and given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling aroma." Peripatetao here is in the Greek present imperative. We said that means that it is commanding an ongoing action. Ongoing. There is no stopping it. There's no end to this thinking process. It is continuous. It is habitual. Or, in other words, it is the way of life for the believing individual. Our thoughts are on divine viewpoint, on the very Word of God. We're not allowing human viewpoint in any way to start to dominate us. Ephesians 5:15 says, "See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise." And then we said, and we went to 2 Corinthians 5:7, "For we walk by faith, not by sight." We've just made a connection that our course of walk is based on our faith. Pistis is the word, is the Greek word. That faith is being convinced that the Word of God, what God is saying to us, what God is us in His Word, and what God's Word says is true.
Amen.
And when we know that God's Word is true, then we really know that He is sovereign in all things. We are persuaded in our spiritual life, we are persuaded in our walk by the very Word of God. Every detail of the Word of God is directing and guiding us. If we are convinced and persuaded by the Word of God, we're not just giving it lip service. A lot of us, you know, so how many times we, you know, each and every one of us have heard people say, and especially with that example that I just gave you prior to this, how we believe in God and we know God's in charge and all that stuff, but yet we believe God says that He needs our help in order to get things accomplished here on earth. That's not divine viewpoint thinking. It's more than giving lip service with that in developing divine viewpoint thinking in all areas of our spiritual life. We will display outwardly what we have been putting inwardly. If we're putting the Word of God in, if we're developing divine viewpoint thinking, we are going to bring that out. We are going to call out what is inside us. We are what we think, and we have some scripture verses for that later on. And so we said there just needs to be a radical change, and it is radical, and it is difficult, and it is a challenge. This isn't easy for us to do, because we are programmed one way, and we need to learn God's Word another way, and to use it and to apply it in another way. That is difficult. That's why it's radical thinking. We are to understand, again, walk, peripateo, and faith, pistis. We're to consider how they go together to completely understand. Peripateo, our walk, and pistis, our faith, is to first know. Think about this. Realize and recognize that every moment of the day for the believer has eternal significance.
That's right.
That is what 1 Corinthians 3:11 through 15 is speaking about. Putting those things that have eternal value, everything that we do, the Word of God, and our walk, completing that circle, is all about divine viewpoint. Everything that we do, we are, God's Word says we are ambassadors for Christ. We are representing Christ. We are representing God's Word. If God's Word is in us, we are bringing that out. We're not bringing out our sin nature, which is a problem, you know, for so many of us, that when we hear something, we want to dig down into the sin nature of us and respond that way instead of responding back with the divine viewpoint thinking that we are to be developing. That's a challenge. But every moment has eternal value. Every unbeliever's eternal life depends on how we respond to things in life. Every unbeliever their eternal destiny may be determined by how we think.
Wow. Yes, sir.
Eternal significance. That's scary. That's scary when we look at it and we see that and when we understand what the meaning of these words are. So we are now on a secure foundation. What are Greek's gifts? What do we build on this foundation? We put gold, silver, precious stones. This is what the passage is about. Where do we put wood, hay, straw? Wood, hay, straw has purpose. Has purpose. But it's going to be burned up. With what we build on this foundation, will it have eternal importance or value? Will it be burned up? Our thinking, this is where we ended, our thinking involves one of two directions. Horizontally, for some earthly good, or it goes vertically and is going to produce eternal value. If our focus, and this is the thing, remember we're talking about earthly good. We can do a lot of things that look good and are good in the earthly way of doing things. Or finding a purpose and a center focus on doing this earthly good. And if that's all that we do in on. And what we teach here at Westside Baptist Church, for instance, is that we've done all this good, and we tell Jesus, look what I've done. Look what I was busy representing and trying to change and trying to fix and do all this stuff and all these good things. And we're standing at the Bema seat of Jesus Christ. And Jesus says, well, okay, that's good, but that's burned up. You have no eternal value because you really didn't do anything for the kingdom. You really didn't do anything for, Jesus saying, for me. You have no eternal value. And we know what the end result of that is. You will not hear, well done, good, faithful servant, because we've done goodly things on here on earth. We need to be doing things that are producing eternal value. God has chosen. That is divine viewpoint. That is divine viewpoint. God has chosen. That is also, let me keep saying, that is continuing the circle. That is not breaking the circle. God has designed a plan for us to produce those things of eternal value. Peripateto, together with pistis, means thinking in divine viewpoint and maintaining a complete circle. Anytime we are thinking in the futility of the mind of the Gentiles, then the circuit or circle is broken, and we are not operating with those things that do not have eternal value. What are we talking about? Remember where Paul is headed. Paul is headed into Ephesians 5:18, being filled with the Holy Spirit. We are not walking by faith that is persuaded or convinced that God's word is true when we're operating in human viewpoint. So there is another word that is closely related to peripateto, and it's going to help us understand even more about our walk in spiritual life, and it's going to make things in our spiritual life even more challenging into changing the way we think. And that is the word stoicheko. It means walking, and we see it in Galatians 5:25, if you want to go there while I'm reading this. It means walking in step. Stay in cadence with God's word or God's will. Let me read that again. There's some sound there. We might not have had that penetrate into our minds. Stoicheko means walking in step, staying in cadence with God's word or God's will. Galatians 5:25. The word is used, and it says, as we said, it says speaking, staying in line. You know, in the military, again, marches. What do? They stay in line. They stay in step. Right step, left step, right step, left step. Anytime someone gets out of line or out of step, they usually get blasted in the back of the head, like with one of those get slaps. Get back in step. Get back in line. This is speaking about staying in line. Galatians 5:25 from the English Standard Version. If we live by the Spirit, let us also keep in step with the Spirit. If we live by the that Bible, if we live by the Spirit, let us also behave in accordance with the Spirit. Galatians, the Holman Christian, since we live by the Spirit, we must also follow the Spirit. And then there's the Amplified, which is a good one. If we live by the Holy Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit. If by the Holy Spirit we have our life in God, let us go forward, walking in line. We're not moving out of line. We're not going this. We're not acting according to our own will, but we are walking in step with the Spirit. Our conduct controlled by the Spirit. And it's all about thinking. It's connected to faith. It's connected to pistis. If we are not staying in line or running with the Holy Spirit. This is, we went through 1 John 1:9. Because maybe we said something or we did something or we acted in a particular way. Again, I'll bring it up. Did we go to 1 John 1:9 because we had some human thought? We were in human thinking in the past week or wherever, whatever time it may have been. If we are not being in exact obedience to the Holy Spirit, to Jesus, to God, And that includes in our thinking, which is what these words are saying, then we are not staying in line. We are not walking in step with the Holy Spirit, who only thinks in divine viewpoint. We are not completing the circle. We are breaking the circle. We are being infiltrated with human viewpoint thinking. And that is why it is so dangerous. And that is why we're going to be, that's why Paul is so emphatic when he begins Ephesians 4:17, is because this is important, because if we open this up in any way, we can be overtaken in human thinking, and it can be very damaging to our spiritual life. That's why he is emphatic. This is why he is saying, pay attention to what I'm writing you.
Amen.
There needs to be a change in the way we think. So Paul is leading all this up, as we said, to Ephesians 5:18, being filled with the Holy Spirit. There's a lot more involved to it than what we really thought there was. So let's take a look as we move into some new material here, and I'm going to try to complete this thought. And I'm going to be flying through this maybe. Ephesians 4:17, 19, Paul writes here in Ephesians, this I say, therefore, and testify. There it is. He's being, this is important. He says, I want you to, I want you to listen to this. In the Lord, that you should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk, in the futility of your mind, having their understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the blindness of their heart. The next study, we're going to pull that whole passage apart. So we're not to walk in the futility of the mind of the Gentiles, the unbelievers. That's what that's what's being represented here. So the question will become, why not? Okay, they got the futility of mind. Well, what does that mean? How does that affect me? Why is that important to me? You know, why shouldn't I do this? Turn, if you will, to the passage of Luke chapter 8, 5 verse 3, 5 through 8. Luke chapter 8, verses 5 through 8. So Jesus telling this parable, a sower went out to sow his seed, and as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and it was trampled down, and the birds of the air devoured it. Some fell on a rock, and as soon as it sprang up, it withered away because it lacked moisture. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it and choked it. But others fell on good ground, sprang up and yielded a crop a hundredfold. When he had said these things, he cried, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. Now the disciples, the apostles there, they asked Jesus the meaning of this passage. And so Jesus in verse 11, starting in verse 11, gives them the explanation to the parable. Now the parable is this. The seed is the word of God. Those by the wayside are the ones who hear, then the devil comes and takes away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. But the ones on the rock are those who, when they hear, receive the word. They receive that word. They receive eternal life with joy. And these have no root, who believe for a while, and in time of temptation fall away. Now the ones that fell among thorns are those who, when they have heard, go out and are choked with cares, riches, and pleasures of life, and bring no fruit to maturity. But, verse 15 there, but the ones that fell on good ground are those who, having heard the word with a noble and good heart, keep it and bear fruit with patience. In eternity past, however far you want to take eternity past, whatever you think it began, you know, 50,000 years ago, a million years ago, a billion years ago, whatever you in your mind think eternity past is, go further back, because that's where eternity past goes. But at that point in time, God had a designed plan, eternal plan, for each of us to participate in his creation. That's awesome. That's one time where you can use the word awesome. That is awesome, that God created us to be used as part of his eternal plan. It was a design plan in which we would be able to experience, this is important to get, to grasp, and able to experience a fellowship and a relationship with the eternal God. That's how important we are. That's how much of an eternal plan that we are involved in. In this design plan, each person, through the grace of God, through His creating powers, that each person would receive complete satisfaction in every detail of life. Wow. That was the plan. There would be complete and perfect harmony between God and His creation. Well, we know what happened there. We know the problem that happened in the garden, the sin, the rebellion, and the intended purpose of that original plan was corrupted. That happened in the garden. Things changed. The world changed, became corrupt. Man was corrupt. However, God knows this. He's all-knowing. He knew it was going to take place. So also part of that eternal plan, and knowing that man's going to rebel, man's going to fall, man's going to stumble, God didn't throw His hands up and say, I quit. Didn't do that. He continued on with that eternal plan, and part of that design plan was that God would provide a way for His creation. Are you getting it? I'm up here by myself. I know I am. God would provide a way for His creation to be satisfied and content in dealing with the details of life.
Yes.
I hope we heard that. Through faith in Jesus Christ for the promise of eternal life and the Word of God, Bible doctrine, there is the availability to live out the spiritual life for success. We're going to see that connects with Ephesians here. It's a choice on the part of the believing individual of whether they want to be spiritual winners or spiritual losers. There are a lot of people, we know them. You would praise what you said. Because you see, a lot of MDQs here, they put a check mark by spiritual losers. Because they don't find the Word of God important and in their priority and the doctrines and the mind. And so many people, their lives are crumbling before them.
Yep.
And that's not God's intention. God wants them to be content. He wants them to live the spiritual life with success. He wants them to be happy in the very details of daily life.
That's right, man.
But they put a check mark there. No, not for me. For the Gentiles, the unbelievers, they were not able to experience this. Which is part of 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 8, 9, 10. They're not able to experience that. And that's why Paul was saying, they're walking their ways. Because they cannot piece together God's Word. Remember the circles we had? We don't have time to go through those. But how all that works and goes together and taking a doctrine and applying it from the gnosis and putting it into the epignosis of our souls, of who we are, who we're thinking, our purpose in what we are studying in the next couple of weeks, and when we break down the words and we really begin to understand what these words mean. It's a challenge to every one of us to carry them out.
Yeah.
It's a challenge. God is not going to sprinkle spiritual dust on us, and we're going to all walk around perfect. He's not going to spray dust on us, and we're going to go to bed tonight, and I'm going to wake up tomorrow and say, boy, I really want to study the Word of God, and I got all this energy. No, because we're battling something that's in us. Yes, it's in nature not to do it.
Come on, sir.
It's a challenge to develop this thinking. That's why Paul, again, in Ephesians 4:17, is saying, look, we also want to show that and we're going to break those down, verses down. We're going to show that the believers in Christ can choose to follow the same path as these unbelievers.
Yes.
That's what Paul's saying. You can choose to follow their ways. In their thinking and in their handling of the details of life. You can go that way. We're going to be looking at the meaning of some important words in Ephesians 4:18, darkened there. We're going to learn about a word, a Greek word for understanding. We're going to look at those two things that they cannot grasp, two things that they cannot get and maintain. As believers, so we are now able to put Bible doctrine together in order to experience the fullness. God had a tremendous plan for us.
Amen.
He wants us to enjoy this. This does not have to be misery of the daily life that we want. We don't have to be miserable. We don't have to be concerned about all these things going on, because God has made it possible for us to experience the fullness of the spiritual life that God has intended for us, simply by His Word. Remember, peripateto, our walk, completing the circle. Remember, pistis, our faith. What do we believe is being challenged as we go through our daily life? So it does not matter what we have experienced in life. It doesn't matter what we have to face on a daily basis.
Yes.
We need not be controlled by those circumstances.
Amen.
You know, the Bible speaks of our future. Every day that we read the Bible, every day that we are in prayer, it is all about our future. It is not about our past. Our past is gone. It is not even about our present, but it is about our future. Every word that we read is about our future, what God has in store for us. He has a plan for us tomorrow, for us to enjoy what we have in Christ. We don't have to be continuing going back. We don't have to stay here. We can move on, because we have the availability of Bible doctrine.
Amen.
Human viewpoint keeps us in the present. Human viewpoint keeps us in the past. Divine viewpoint points us to the future. There are only two ways that we can respond to the details of life: as Gentiles with human viewpoint, or Bible doctrine, divine viewpoint.
That's it.
Anytime we respond with human viewpoint, we are then rejecting Bible doctrine. Walking the circle, making sure it's complete, not breaking it. Staying in cadence with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit only thinks. If we're going out in human viewpoint, the Holy Spirit's not there. The Holy Spirit don't go with us. The Holy Spirit only thinks in divine viewpoint. We will show that through the scriptures in the next few verses on how we have reached this understanding of what all that I'm trying to convey at this point. We can continue to think like Gentiles. We can continue to think like the unbelievers, with all their philosophies, with all of their ideas, with all their purpose in looking for satisfaction, looking for happiness, looking for joys, looking for pleasures. We can continue to think in their terms, and we will be miserable believers in Christ, struggling to cope in this life and to reach some point of satisfaction and happiness for ourselves, not realizing we already have that if we just apply the Word of God. Such things as depression, anxiety, worries will be controlled. And trust me, I know a little bit about this stuff. Worries will be controlling us instead of the Word of God.
Yeah.
That's the bottom line. That's the bottom line. So let's go back to our passage in Luke as we get ready to close. About 5 minutes. Here we see a good example. Okay. Shouldn't do that, because I'm going by that clock. You said that clock's what? 5 minutes slow. Here we see a good example of applying or rejecting Bible doctrine. Remember our 40 grace gifts? Study on that, the building on the foundation, those things that have eternal value. In that passage that we read in Luke, three of those four soils, and if you're a Calvinist, you disagree with that, and that's your problem. But three of the four soils that the seed fell on are saved individuals.
Yes.
Only the first one is an unsaved individual who rejected the offer of eternal life. Those in the second and third soils are the ones, we want to be honest, we really want to look at this, I always say, which soil am I in? That's me. Which soil am I in? This second and third soils are the ones where Bible doctrine is not controlling their lives. They are caught up, especially in the third soil. They are caught up in the cares of the world. Everything they're trying to grasp, they're trying to hold on to both ends of the stick. They'll hold on to God on one end, they're holding on to the world on the other end, and they're trying to live life accordingly. They're caught up in the cares of the world. The ones who fell on the fourth soil, and I hope we get this, are the ones in which, and really what Paul is saying here, they're listening, these are the ones that are listening to Paul in Ephesians here. They're the ones in which Bible doctrine, they're completing the circle. They're guarding the perimeter. They are walking continuously in cadence with the Holy Spirit in their spiritual life. And they are controlled by doctrine.
Right.
These are the ones that get the accommodations from the Lord. Their focus is on those things that have eternal value. You see, they don't have anything really in common with the second and third seed, especially the third soil. The third was all caught up in everything that's going on in the world. They want to grab all this satisfaction. They want to grab all this pleasure. They want all these things. They're combining their spiritual life with the worldly, humanistic life. They're not compared. They have nothing in common with the fourth soil, who's doing everything according to what God is asking them to do in their divine viewpoint thinking. They are focused on those things that have eternal value, and they are the ones that receive the rewards.
Yes.
They are producing fruit, and they are living out the design plan that God has for all of us. They are satisfied. They are content in life. So it comes down as we close. What is the attitude we bring, including me, what is the attitude we bring concerning the learning and applying Bible doctrine to our spiritual life? What is it that we're learning? You know, we're going to talk a little bit, and I can't stop, but, you know, we're going to talk about the scar tissue of the soul, building up this scar tissue and rejecting Bible doctrine. See, you don't need to see a show of hands and say, who's going to make a commitment to the Lord today not to think of divine viewpoint? You've already made that choice. Anybody listening has already made that choice of whether they want this doctrine or they don't want that doctrine. Hmm. What is the attitude that we bring concerning learning and applying Bible doctrine to our spiritual life? We're already developing that attitude toward that thinking in divine viewpoint in all areas of our spiritual life. Or we've already decided to continue in human viewpoint in all parts of our thinking. And next time I'll pick up where we're going to leave off here. But let me read Proverbs 23:7. For as he thinks in his heart, so he is. Eat and drink, he says to you, but his heart is not with you. 2 Corinthians 10:4-5. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments at every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. A lot of people don't want to read obedience to Christ. That's walking in cadence to the Holy Spirit. So, Ephesians 4:17 tells us that the Gentiles walk in the futility of their mind. Ephesians will give us the ongoing results of that futility. Their understanding is darkened. They are alienated from the life of God. There is blindness, a hardness. There's a callousness that is building up in their heart, which believers can also do themselves with the rejection of doctrine. And this is where we are, as I said, going to draw on a scar tissue to soul. We can reject doctrine enough times to where we become callous. callous to the very word, and it will have no positive effect in our spiritual life.
That's right.
We will become spiritual losers and not spiritual winners. This is why Paul says in Ephesians 4:17, for us to pay attention to what he is about to say, because it's that important to the success of our spiritual life.
That's it. Amen.
Let us close. Our Lord.